Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Mandatory Social Interaction Show. I almost forgot the name of the show. This is like I was halfway into that sentence. I was like, oh, no. Hope everybody's doing well today. I am joined with the lovely co-host, Tim, as always.
Hello.
And we are playing...
You didn't introduce yourself, Ben.
Oh, well, whatever. I'm too famous. Everybody knows who I am by now. No, my name is Ben, and I do music stuff, and we are playing Minecraft, and which is tradition for the first episode of the weekend. And I
make sure you switch off of your splash screen. Okay, I just want to make sure that's...
I did like right away. but yeah, it's kind of our tradition to play Minecraft right away, and
it
then
is.
We kind of switch to something else
because we're building a nice little like city type deal here.
Yeah, we need to...
Town. We need to get more cows and stuff.
Keep working on that.
I'm going to keep digging, though. I'm going to go down and dig some more. How you doing,
man? I was thinking I was going to work on my my stairway and portal out in the middle of nowhere. But I was going to say something. I can't remember what it was.
I interrupted
it's
you.
Friday.
How I do.
Which is nice.
It is Friday. It's Friday. I had a day off today. Can't complain. I had some sushi this afternoon. I am feeling fat and happy right now.
Can't complain about that at all.
Oh, no. Yeah, we have a conveyor belt sushi place.
Oh.
Yeah, in our mall. It's called Yo Sushi. And it is freaking amazing. They have some of the best sushi. And they have sushi that comes around on conveyor belts, and you can special order stuff. And it's great. And the prices aren't too bad either.
So. Hmm. I think I've been to one of those once. I'm not much of a sushi guy, but that's mostly because I don't like fish, and most sushi kind of revolves around fish in some way.
Some of it does, yeah. I mean, the more Americanized sushi, like California rolls and stuff like that, but the traditional stuff is very, very fish focused. There's a lot of shrimp and stuff like that, so yeah,
which
I can understand your hesitance. I absolutely love it, though. Planning on going to Japan with Reki next year, so, you know.
You gotta get used to it now.
Well, you know. I'm gonna eat like a king, let's just say that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's cool.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. So, anything exciting going on this weekend? Or this
I
week?
Am mostly just working on stuff, really. Adjusting my volume a little bit here.
No.
I have a lot of work to do. Oh, God, I just opened my gate. There we go. Opened the gate to the chickens. so I am working on a couple albums, and I'm trying to get on top of a bunch of other projects that I have going on, and it's kind of crazy town right now. But hopefully over the next couple weeks/months, I'll be in a more sane position again, and then I'll be able to think and have... good night's sleeps and
wouldn't
you know,
that be nice?
All that other stuff that
nice change of pace.
Seems like a rarity these days. So yeah, what are you up to? What's going on with you?
Well, I guess my birthday festivities continue tomorrow. My birthday was yesterday, the 8th, so
happy birthday again.
Thank you. Thanks for hanging out with me on my stream, by the way. It was fun.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, last night I had a really good stream till like 2 a.m.
Oh my god.
Yeah, we went late and we played World of Warcraft till the wee hours, me and some friends, and I got to hang out with chat, which was pretty sweet. Honestly, wouldn't want to spend my birthday any other way, so it was pretty great.
Right? I mean, it sounds weird to be like, what'd you do on your birthday? Well, I hung out on the internet with some people I barely know, and if you put it that way, it sounds weird, but when you actually like sit down and do it, you're just like, oh yeah, these people are awesome, and...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everyone was super nice, and you know everybody wished me a happy birthday, which was awesome. And
yeah,
you know, I mean, where else do you get that where you don't have to spend a ton of money? So
yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
we have an excess of eggs in our in our chests. Holy crap!
You want to go throw them in the pen to get some more chickens?
Oh, we have like 200 eggs.
Wow, that's a lot of freaking eggs.
Yeah, I'm level 30 now. Maybe I can enchant something cool.
Yeah, go for it. I'm at 27, so I'm working my way towards
well,
30
I have
again.
I have an Unbreaking 3 pickaxe, a diamond one. And I have a diamond sword, but that has Unbreaking 1 on it. Yeah, this is the best book ever, because it has Unbreaking 2 and 3 in it.
I've got Efficiency 4 and Fortune 3 on my my pickaxe, so.
That's good too, though.
Yeah, Efficiency's nice. I wish it was unbreaking, though, because this thing won't last forever then, but.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Well, you can repair them. Like, didn't we talk about that last time?
Yeah, we have to make an anvil, though, and anvils are super hard to make.
Oh.
They're expensive and they can break really easily if you're unlucky.
Oh, well, I didn't know that.
Yeah, I think that's the only downside to them, but. Whatever.
Yeah. Well, we were talking about something, as is tradition, we were talking about something before we started recording, and now I can't remember what it was.
Well, I was talking about playing World of Warcraft more on my stream because of Overwatch. I was really heavy into playing Overwatch and streaming it because Overwatch is a pretty fun game. I mean, it's not a bad game at all.
It is a fun game.
Problem is that, at least on PC, I don't know about consoles, from what I hear, the console communities are better, but on PC there's a lot of salt and toxicity, and to the point where people call it oversalt.
Oh,
like,
boy.
No joke. Like, there's so much friggin' salt, and it's ridiculous. And, I get a little tired of it, and it was kind of bleeding over into my my own stream a little bit with some of the people I was playing with, and got a little frustrating at times. And I'm not saying that salt doesn't happen, because it happens to all of us, it happens to me.
But it's a competitive game. I mean, that's kind of part of the game, unfortunately,
correct,
to some degree.
Yes, and you're correct. But it was getting to a point where it was actually, like, ruining the experience for me. So I've decided to take a step back. I uninstalled the game, and I'm going to just avoid playing it for a little while. At the very least, on stream. I may play it off stream, but even then, I don't know if I'm that interested in playing it beyond that. So it's unfortunate because it's like fun game, and it's got a lot of cool stuff to it, and you know, I mean, it is what it is, right? You can't either take the whole thing or you stop playing it, right? And that's kind of the way that I looked at it. It's like, well, I can either sit here and get salty every night on stream and never ever grow because people don't come here to see that. Or
the people you want in your stream anyway, or in your chat.
Correct, or I can stop playing the game and play other games that are much more friendly for people to watch and less hostile overall.
Yeah.
So, because nobody wants to see a salty streamer, it's just, you know.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's good. I mean, it's good that you're self-aware enough to be able to do that. I mean, some people do that, and it's just like I see on like Reddit, because I go to like Reddit, Twitch, and all that other stuff. And I see people, it's just like, why is my streams dying? Why don't people, like, show up? And then they show videos of their streams, and they're just being D-bags to, like, everybody.
Well,
and
that's
just like, well, there's a very good reason why nobody's showing up to your stream.
And you know, that brings up a totally valid thing, because it honestly is a big reason why so many streamers don't succeed, is because they aren't cut out for streaming, and it's okay to say you're not good at something.
Uh-huh.
Because, like, one of the things that I know I am good at is talking with people and is interacting with people. I love doing it. It's a little nerve-wracking sometimes, but it's one of the things that really energizes me and gets me going. And, you know, I love it. So when people are like, man, you know, I only, you know, call everyone a dickhead 50 times when I play a game, why does nobody want to watch me? It's like, because you're a dickhead. Because you're the dickhead, you know? You're the reason that people don't want to watch you play a game, is because you're not fun to watch. And I'm not saying I know everybody's situation, but I am saying that people tend, and this is a tendency, oh my god, that guy has enchanted pants on. he looks like MC Hammer. It was pretty crazy.
Nice.
He does. He's got, like, parachute pants on, and they're, like, purple and brown.
I wonder if that's, like, a unique monster or something.
Nah, it's just a skeleton wearing pants.
Oh.
Pretty funny. But yeah, so it's just, when you go into streaming, you got to be very conscious that other people watch you because they want to have fun too. They're not watching you just because they like you. It helps, but they're watching you because they want to see the game played, and they want somebody behind the wheel that they can identify with and interact with.
And not even necessarily see the game played well. Like, I think that's a distinction that a lot of people don't fully understand,
right,
is that you don't have to play the game well, you just have to be interesting enough to watch.
Yes, yes. And it's the gameplay they want to see and interact with the streamer. Those are the big things. And I don't think a lot of people realize that that's what a lot of people just want. They just want a really chillax kind of experience. And I mean, I've been told numerous times by my own chat that that's all they want, is they want a relaxed environment that they can come and watch games be played. And if I'm, you know, salty and yelling and screaming and pissed off, that really has a negative effect on the quality of my stream and how much they enjoy themselves.
Yeah.
And when you're a streamer, your focus isn't the games. Your focus is the people watching, because you want to grow, and the only way to grow is to give your emphasis, give your focus, and give your energy to the people watching.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something that I think a lot of, I don't know if I should say younger, but newer streamers, I don't know if age plays any role in it, but newer streamers don't seem to realize, is that people are there to watch you and watch the gameplay. They're there, not there to be bitched at, moaned at, complained at. You know, they're there to have a good time, not have a miserable, horrible time. So
yeah.
For me, like, oops, if I'm playing a game like Star Wars Battlefront, which can get very frustrating because the game is really horribly built and really terribly balanced.
But it's Star Wars, so it's cool.
But it's Star Wars, so it's cool. But I do have my moments where I'm just like, what the hell's going on? This is really frustrating and aggravating. And yeah, it has its moments, I'll just say. And it really is one of those things where I'll finish a game and I'll say, okay, moving on, playing another game. And I'll have only played for 30 minutes. And it's like, you know, I understand that some people come in there to watch Battlefront, but they don't come in there to watch me get really, really angry while I play Battlefront. So it's like, as a streamer, you have to really put a lot of time and effort and energy into being upbeat. And I think that's something that people don't realize a lot, is that, like, attitude is a big part of why people like streamers.
Well, and it's not exactly obvious when you first start either, because when you see somebody streaming, they're just like, oh, they're playing a game, and they're also talking to people, but
right,
it's like, it's a huge, huge part of the process.
Yes.
Just being aware of what's going on outside of the game and being interactive and all this other stuff.
Well, it's really difficult to pay attention to a chat, play a game, talk about a topic and keep on topic, and you know, and actually do, you know, marginally well at a game. Like, you can't be like so awful that you're, you know, frustratingly awful, but,
well, yeah, there's a threshold.
Yes, like, you can't be like grandma bad, but you know,
grandma bad.
that's a thing now. It's a new thing.
But new, like, t-shirt.
Yeah,
coming to Teespring.
I should put that out there, but yeah, you just can't like expect it to succeed without putting a lot of effort and energy into it.
Yeah, and it is a lot. Like, I've been finding out over the past, because I've been doing this now for about 9 months, and you've been doing it for about a year and a half or 2 years.
Two years in November.
Gotcha. That's a long time. And
it is.
I mean, it's like I'm starting to figure out that it's like, you got to have a schedule, and you have to be organized. You can't just be like, well, I'm going to stream today, because that doesn't really get you very far.
Right. And I mean, you can always do one-off streams. Like,
oh, yeah,
if you're off on a Friday, like today, like I played a lot of World of Warcraft today, but, and I do want to talk about WoW later. But anyways, I played a bunch of World of Warcraft today, and I could have easily streamed it. And even if none of my regulars were around, if none of them were home or on, I still would have, you know, it still would have been a bonus stream for people who were there. And it helps you grow. But if you don't have a set schedule that you can stick with, it causes a lot of issues for people who want to watch you because they don't know when you're going to stream.
Yeah. Yeah, having a schedule is just as important. And I have a friend who's actually just starting out, and I'm like, one of the most important things you can do is setting a schedule, even if it's just one day a week, because that allows you, that allows you to get consistency with what you're doing, and it's so important to have consistency.
Yeah, people are wired for that sort of stuff. Consistency.
Because yeah, like next
routines and schedules, people, that's just how people are built. That's how we are.
Because I know next Wednesday, I have a prior engagement for my 2-hour track challenge, which is basically us doing this because of scheduling issues.
Yes.
And I know that I'm gonna have to take some special precautions when it comes to you know, setting that up. Like, I'm gonna have to change my offline image on Twitch to be like, hey, I'm not gonna be here this week, because I know people just show up without necessarily having the email alert.
Right. Because they expect it. They know the timing.
Yeah, it's part of their day. And, I mean, it's crazy flattering that it is part of somebody's day or week. But you just have to learn to respect people in that way.
Well, yeah, because not only are they giving you their time, you're taking their time. So if you don't show up and they don't realize it, whether even if it's by notification, a simple notification via Twitter, like, hey, I'm sick or hey, I'm busy, you know, it's really important that they know, because that's how they plan their day sometimes. Some people do that, and I know I do around whenever there's something important that I want to do, and Well, it's one of those things where you've got to, like, be respectful of their time because they respect your time. So, you know, like, where, you know, it's just a mutual respect thing, I think.
Yeah.
And a lot of people don't realize that that's a thing. Like, you have to do that as a streamer. It's a challenge, man. The whole thing is a big challenge. It's a big puzzle.
It is. But, I mean, I've found the whole process to be really rewarding in the end, though. Just how everything works together and just learning how to interact with people, because I'm not good at interacting with people. And, just being a part of a community and helping create a community, even if I'm not exactly at the center of it, it's just, I don't know. There's a lot of cool things that you can do when you have people.
Oh,
I don't
dear
know
God.
Where I'm going with that. What's
oh
up?
My God, I'm getting mobbed.
I can't help you. I'm way far away. I hope you figure it out.
Gotta eat and get my health back, and then there's like 5 zombies here. Okay, anyways, so...
World of Warcraft.
All right, so World of Warcraft.
Unless you had something else on that other topic.
I don't think so. World of Warcraft. I've been playing that again. I picked that up with the wife, and Legion is actually really good. I'm very pleasantly surprised at how it is. I don't know if you've ever played World of Warcraft. Get out of here, you zombie jerk.
No, I had an account for a very long time. If I did a slash played, I'd probably have about 2 or 3 weeks under my belt.
That's not too bad.
If not more. I definitely played that game a lot.
All right. Okay.
All right, now, ladies. What?
Sorry, I'm getting just decimated by
these zombies. Outcast.
It's like a zombie squad over here. Hashtag squad goals. But yeah, I started playing it again, and I mean, I played it for 6 years, 6.5 years, and I probably had like six months of played time by the time I quit. I played a lot of World of Warcraft, and actually to a point where it was legitimately an addiction for me.
Oh yeah,
it was a dependence on the game. For my social interactions, for my fun factor, all that stuff. So, naturally, my wife had a lot of hesitance letting me, you know, working with me to play the game again. But the game has differed enough that I've grown up enough that I don't think it's a problem for me. I know that a lot of people say that, but it's not like a chemical dependence where it's like, I can quit. Like, it's just an emotional dependence, I guess, is kind of the word I'm looking for, if that's a thing.
Oh, yeah. It's psychological. I mean,
psychological.
It's the whole sunk cost fallacy where it's just like, oh, I've put literally thousands of hours into this and now I just want to quit. Like, that doesn't make sense.
And I went through that pretty hard when I did initially quit the game. And right now I know my screen is black because it's dark and I have no torches. So I apologize to those watching my stream. But anyways, I've got my contrast turned up high enough that I can see what I'm doing, at least. kind of can see where I'm going, but yeah. So it was one of those things for me where it was like, I have absolutely no reason to quit this game, because why would I do that? I've spent so much time of my life in this game. I've made such great friends, and I made some friends, but the thing is that none of them are my friends anymore. I don't even talk to any of them. So it was just kind of a cycle of life, I guess, for me. Mm-hmm. And I've kind of grown out of that phase of my life and grown into the my more adult phase of life. And as a streamer, I'm fully aware that watching, you know, just playing one game would be murder for my stream personally, because I am a variety streamer, and switching to just one game means I'm not a variety streamer anymore. So So one of the big things that is good for me, that I've got going for me, is that there is no way I can, like, quote-unquote relapse and full-on, you know, go back into the addiction stage I was in back in high school and early college, is that I've grown up and I've got other commitments that I've got, that I've, you know, committed myself to. I've got other things in my life that I've committed myself to, including my family and my dogs, and you know, I can't neglect them for you know, for a video game anymore. And and I mean, I owe it to my streamers who have already, or to my stream viewers who have given me so much freaking time and energy of their own to making my stream what it is, because they are the reason my stream is what it is, that I can't just go back into the game, you know, on a permanent basis. I can play it a lot on stream.
Oh, yeah.
To be fair, I mean, the option is there, because as a variety streamer, I can get sucked into a game as much as I want because it's my stream. But I do owe it to my stream watchers to play a variety of games. Otherwise, I'm a really crappy variety streamer. So,
well, and the thing is, I mean, thinking about it from the other way, the metrics, it's like there's probably so many people playing WoW. You're not going to get recognized, and you're not going to grow your channel.
Correct. And especially with a new expansion pack, I am literally one of the many, you know, when it comes to that, is I am just another statistic in that list, because Everybody's like, oh, well, new expansion, everyone's playing it. Now, so there won't be much growth until about 5-6 months down the line. If I'm still stuck on it, if I'm still playing it, and I'm doing raids and stuff, people will probably tune in for that. Because then you get to see the big bosses killed and all that stuff, because some people just don't want to sink the time or energy into, you know, doing the end game content like that.
Yeah.
So
no, I was one of those people. I loved raiding. Like, I had a lot of fun raiding.
That's what got me hooked, was the raid. The raid aspect of the game was, you know, you really can get heavily involved in the game with a guild, and they come to rely on you, and they have specific times that they meet, and certain, you know, and you've got certain responsibilities, like you have to gather materials for everybody and yada yada yada. So it does get very time consuming, and like what is interesting is that when it comes to playing World of Warcraft again, I'm not too concerned with being sucked in because I'm a streamer now. I think my only concern is if I did say I'm going to become involved in streaming and I'm going to become involved in a guild and all this stuff, I don't think I'd be able to give them my time, so I don't know if it'd be right for me to do.
Yeah, so, I mean, unless the guild was your stream community.
Right.
And then it would make sense, because Then you'd have a community that you could always, you know, form around. But
so it's one of those things that if I were to become involved in raiding again, which I don't know if I want to, because of the time, because I mean, you're talking 4 hours a week most weeks, 4+ hours a week most weeks. And I'm not saying time's a factor, because time's not really a factor, because you have the time. I mean, Shaka Panda said that on your interview. You have the time. It's just a matter of making the correct use of it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, do I want to commit myself to potentially 4+ hours a week streaming this game? And would the leadership of the guild that I raid with be okay with me streaming their raids, because some people are very private with the way they do things. They have like specific ways that they do bosses and stuff. That,
oh boy.
You know, if you come up with a method, sometimes you don't want to share it until, you know, you really get it down pat and, you know, you're further than everyone else type thing. So I don't know.
I've never been in a group that's been further than anybody else.
Yeah. And I don't know if I mean, I have been, and methods and stuff are usually shared with upper crust of guilds.
Mm-hmm.
And then trickled down into the guilds before it hits the internet, because people do like to keep it secret sometimes. Like, if they come up with a special method, even if it's like, especially if it's like a way of bugging out the boss or glitching the boss, because they can get banned if it leaks, they'll often keep that close to their chest. So it's one of those things that, like, I'd have to make sure the leadership of the guild was okay with it. I'd have to make sure everybody in the guild was okay being streamed and have their voice on my stream.
Yeah.
And it's just, it's a logistical nightmare at this point. So, and I don't even know if I'm gonna, like, be at a point where I can raid. So there's a lot of, like, up in the air things with it. And as cool as the game is, like I said, I don't know if I could ever get, like, I'd like to, but I don't think I could ever get involved as I was in the game, you know?
Yeah.
So I'm gonna make the attempt, because I'd like the opportunity to try to you know, kind of relive some of that past glory, but I'm not going to do it at the expense of my own stream or my, you know, my family life or anything.
Yeah. And that's good. I mean, it's good to have that, those limitations set upon yourself.
Yes.
Even if they're self-imposed. I mean, you can...
I'm not a kid anymore. You know, it's like, you really can't, you just can't stick your time like in that, because like it got to a point where like I would be up, like I used to play from, I'd get home from school like at like 2:30 or 3 in high school. I'd hop on WoW around like 4 or 5 and play till 2 a.m. Probably later than that, probably till like 3 or 4 most nights. Get a couple hours of sleep, be up, and go to school the next day. And I would do that every freaking night for, I did that for months.
Yeah, I had a roommate like that with Final Fantasy XI. He actually, I don't even know if he had a bed in his room. He just had a couch in front of his computer.
Yeah.
He had some serious problems, but it was the same thing where it's just, he would just play. He would work. I think he worked at like FedEx or something. So he only had like part-time anyway.
Right.
So he would work and he'd just come home and like eat a box of mac and cheese and play that game until like 2 a.m. and then just go to sleep. And
that's a psychological dependence on the game. It's an addiction. Oh, yeah. And I admit that I had that problem. And I think that's the biggest challenge was when I was in high school. It was, no, I'm not. I just really like the game. It's just all that I'm interested in right now. No, you're legit. You're addicted to the game. Because if you can't go, a weekend without saying, I need to log into my WoW account and check my stuff, you've got a problem.
Fall into that trap too.
And it is. And like today I had some free time because I had the day off, and I had transferred one of my old characters over from my old realm into the new realm that I joined with some friends, and I was playing it a little bit, and I was like, you know, I can see the allure, like I can see where I went wrong and what like really kind of yanked me in a little bit. So it's interesting to see it from a more mature perspective, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
If that makes sense, like, it's fascinating to see like where I went wrong. I'll be honest. I mean, I will never, you know, hate WoW because of what it did give me. It gave me, connections to people. It made me more interested in the internet. It taught me a lot about leadership. It really did, which was a big deal. And that's a positive takeaway.
Oh, yeah. There's a lot of positive takeaways.
Yeah, and one of the things that people say is they're like, well, you know, that was just a waste of time. Not particularly. I mean, I did get a lot out of it, and I had a really cool guild that taught me how to, handle big groups of people without, like, being a jerk. Like, actually making an impression on people and working with people closely and, you know, stuff that I actually use in my everyday job.
Yeah, and I think we've talked about it before, but it's just like having those kind of opportunities to lead people in a safe environment. I think we talked about this with the Dungeons & Dragons stuff and just like role-playing games.
Yeah.
Being able to work with people in a safe environment and encounter these dire, I guess, in some ways, situations. And like, you know, there is stuff on the line, even though it's not like people's lives, it's people's times that they've invested in this game.
Right, their characters and all that stuff.
Like, people are invested, and people, I mean, there's very analogous situations to real life that you can pull from this.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of interesting, like, things. And I did the same thing. I think I ran, not in WoW, but in a game called Asheron's Call, like, back in the early 1990s or something, there was a game by Microsoft called Asheron's Call, and I ran a guild there. And I did not realize how much work it was until I was very, very committed.
Yes.
And it was a lot of fun, but I definitely learned a lot about just how to deal with people. And like that didn't really, I mean, I was in high school and I was a dumb kid, so I didn't really fully understand what I was learning at the time. But especially now in the age of the internet, it's definitely something that I really appreciate that I learned and figured out.
Well, and it also teaches you about time commitments and how to meet your time commitments. I mean, there's a lot of positive things that come out of games like MMORPGs and stuff. that if you get involved with a raiding guild or an active guild of some kind, because when I joined, I was involved in a roleplay server. I mean, I've talked about my passion for roleplaying in the past. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that fed into it because I was able to roleplay with people and, you know, you would get involved with meetings in cities at certain times. And, you know, it was interesting and it was a good lesson in time management, above all, I think.
Yeah.
That was the big one was, it was just lots of very interesting, stuff that I pulled out of that. Part of the reason I have my job is because I was very involved with the 501st Legion, which was a costuming club that does the Imperials from Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
And I was involved with them, and then I got my internship at the place I work at now. Excuse me. Oof. Had to yawn. I was sitting there, I managed their forums and their website and stuff for a very long time, for several years. And I was on their website and kind of tinkering around with their site and talking with people and things like that. And one of the guys, because I had applied for a more permanent position at the place that I'm working at, and they, I was just a lowly intern, and one of the guys that was working in the group, in the service desk, which is where I'd applied, was walking by and saw my screen and was like, "Hey man, you like Star Wars, huh?" And we talked about Star Wars for like 30 minutes, and then he went back to the lady who was doing the hiring and said, "You've got to hire him because he's awesome." And the reason that I was able to be involved in that costuming club was because I was involved in guilds and knew how structure worked and all that stuff. And that was the reason that I got involved with the 501st, not because of the cool costumes, but because there was a structure. There was a hierarchy, there was leadership, and there were people that would call the shots and help organize events. And it was one of those things that was really helpful to me. And I mean, the military gives that to a lot of people, but I didn't join the military. I wasn't interested in being in the military.
Yeah.
Have been, never will be. And it's one of those things that, like, I got that from a video game. That's valuable. That's powerful stuff. And so I think World of Warcraft has had more positive effect on my life than negative, because my wife was the one who introduced me in the first place, and I ended up neglecting her a lot when we were in high school and stuff, which was not good. But
no.
She was gracious enough to stick through that with me, and you know, ever since, it's been a worry of hers because she doesn't want me to fall into that pit again.
Mm-hmm.
But it's nice because we play the game together now. And we actually actively play it together. And we don't have a lot of games that we can play together because she likes JRPGs. And, she's just very into, like, single-player experiences. She loves, like, Fallout and stuff like that. And I don't. I like multiplayer experiences. And this kind of gives you the best of both worlds, an MMO. You can play by yourself if you want to. You can go collect pets. You can go battle pets. You can go explore and get titles and achievements and all this stuff. Or... you can play with your friends, you can play with people, you can get involved in a guild, you can play with your wife, you know, all that stuff. So it's kind of this great meeting ground for both of us in terms of our interests. So, and I could talk about World of Warcraft for eons just because, like I said before, I friggin' love the game. I always have, and I have a new respect for it because of what they've changed in this new expansion. To mm-hmm. really bring it back to its glory days a bit, so.
Yeah, and I'm interested in the game. I just don't want to get drawn into it again. And I think that's reasonable.
It is, and that's a fair thing. And but it's one of those things that even Christine might be interested in, and you guys can just limit yourselves to like a couple hours and only play together type stuff.
Well, yeah, and we play Guild Wars.
Yes, and it's.
The primary reason why we played Guild Wars is because there wasn't a monthly fee, so we wouldn't feel bad for not playing.
You wouldn't feel like you need to put the time into it.
Yeah.
But it got to a point where Recky and I had Final Fantasy accounts, Final Fantasy 14, and we were paying for it monthly, and we literally just didn't log in, and we didn't play. And it wasn't a, we've got to play to get our money's worth. It was a, we need to cancel this because we're not playing it type
thing. Yeah.
And that to me was where I was like, you know what? That tells me that I'm not hooked on MMOs anymore, and I don't feel like the money, you know, that sunk cost fallacy, like you said,
mm-hmm.
you know, I don't feel like I have an obligation to put a certain amount of time into the game to make that money worth it. It was just like, well, I'm not playing it, so I don't need to pay for it. And that was that. And I was like, that was my light bulb on moment where it's like, holy crap, like that, I'm cured, you know, like, praise Jesus, hallelujah, you know, that sort of thing. Where it was just like, I don't need the game. Like, I don't need to have it in my life. Like, I can play without it. And that wasn't long ago. And that's why I was like, you know what, Legion's coming out. I think it's time to give it a dust off and try. Because I played Mists of Pandaria right before Warlords of Draenor, and I played Warlords of Draenor, and those were both awful. They were terrible, horrible expansion packs. Totally made the game like almost unbearably bad for me. I know some people really enjoyed those expansion packs. I did not. But overall, it was pretty. They were pretty rough. And for a while there, I was like, I'm probably never going to come back to WoW. And then I started looking at what Legion offered and what it was going to give me and give everybody. And I was like, this is pretty freaking sweet. I think this is worthwhile. I think this is worth a try. So yeah, I honestly, and I'll just say this to you: if you ever decide to get involved with it, it's one of those things that there are people that you know that play it.
Yeah,
like me and Ray, who is my sister-in-law, who just started streaming, by the way, and she's actually really good.
But I should check that out.
And Recky and Ray. And Chris, her boyfriend, and his brother Joe, they're all really cool. And it's one of those things where, like, if you ever did want to play it, and I'm just saying, if you ever decide to, I'm not trying to sell you the drug,
you pusher. You know?
But I'm just telling you that you would have a guild and a group of people that could play with, and Christine, of course, as well, that you guys could just pop on a TeamSpeak and play games, because they play games at ridiculous hours. They go from like midnight to 2 a.m. like every night. Because they're hourly, so they have really weird schedules, and they both work at Best Buy right now. So it doesn't open till like 9 or 10, and so they can just be up like ridiculous. And I'm just like, I hate you guys. Like they play. So usually it's on like Friday nights I'll be able to join them, and Saturday nights I can join them and play until like 1 or 2. It's just I can't play any other nights, and it's one of those things that I may play a little bit here and there on stream, but that's how I'm keeping myself accountable as much as I can is I'm going to try to make it just a stream thing. Or if I'm like home from work one day or sick or something, and I just want to sit in my PJs and play a game, I can do that and not have to worry about streaming it. But
I mean, that's the thing. Like I would enjoy playing it, but I have a problem right now. And that is too many things to do.
Yeah.
So like it's possible that next year, if you guys are still playing, I'll think about it, and I'll talk to Christine about it, because she does like those games. She really liked Guild Wars, and she rags on WoW just because she does. I don't think she really fully understands the type of game that it is.
Right.
She rags on it just because, you know, it's the big one that everybody can talk about, and everybody knows.
Yeah, and it is easy to, and it, I mean that's there's got to be a name for that sort of thing, because that happens to every major game. I mean, Call of Duty gets a lot of crap, and yeah, it's uninnovative, and it's the same year after year, but it's not a bad game.
No.
So the way people rag on it is they're just like, this game is crap. It's a terrible... It's not terrible. It's not bad. It's not even a bad game. I mean, Star Wars Battlefront wasn't even a bad game. I mean, it was a terrible Star Wars game, but it's not bad. It just has a lot of issues that they could fix. They just don't want to.
Yeah, and she's mostly just like, just joking whenever something bad happens. He's just like, I'm going to quit my WoW, or I'm deleting my WoW account, or, you know, whatever. Like, she doesn't even have a WoW account. Right. But it's like, you know, it's one of those things where people get so invested in the game, it kind of tarnishes the game itself.
Right. But there's also something to be said about the active community that WoW has. Like, they have had diehards forever.
15 years now?
No, they've been going for 11 now, I think.
11, okay.
11 or 12,
I heard 15.
They're not that far in, but yeah, it's one of those things that's like, you know, the WoW playing basement nerd like was perpetuated in Make Love Not Warcraft and South Park. Yeah, my favorite South Park episode, by the way.
It is pretty
because
good.
It was so well done, and it was so much of it was true, like so funny and stuff like that. That it was just like it was one of those things that was like a love letter, like literally, like honestly, like a love letter to WoW players, but it was also poking fun at the silliness that WoW was known for, and like the stereotypes WoW was known for, even if they weren't true. Because seriously, like when WoW was in its heyday, people people played that game, but most of the people that played it were just normal, you know, hadn't, you know, 9-to-5 jobs and crap like that. And it wasn't unusual for that to be a thing. Like, seriously, like, it was amazing to me. Like, it was either, I found that it was either like high school age or just your standard 9-to-5ers who were either socially awkward or just didn't, you know, make friends well in real life, or lived in like the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
And like were able to make friends and actually make connections. So I know we're talking a lot about WoW this episode, so I'm sorry, but
it's a big game.
And well, I'm finally getting back into it, and it finally has clicked. Like, because like I said, in Mists of Pandaria and Warlords of Draenor, I was just like, why the heck do people still play this crap? You know,
yeah.
Like it was that rough. Like it was pretty bad. And so it's one of those things where I finally am seeing the appeal again. So it's like, finally, the game actually feels like not butt. Like, it feels awesome again. It's not butts. So, I'm just really excited by that. Like, I think that's pretty awesome.
Well, it's worth being excited over. I mean, the main reason why I quit initially is because I realized all I was doing was I was logging in, doing my dailies, and logging out. Because I felt like some kind of obligation to do it. And then, realizing that, I realized immediately after that those dailies take an hour every day. So it's basically just doing an hour's worth of work every day for like no particular reward, just that I feel obligated to do it.
Right. Was for gold or for reputation,
yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, it was for rep or something. It was something dumb.
Yeah.
But
That was a big problem at the end of Burning Crusade, and actually that was the biggest problem in Mists of Pandaria. Like, in Mists of Pandaria, oddly enough, pretty much what would happen is if you weren't a raider, you would log in, you would level up from, what was it, to 90, I think it was?
Yeah,
was max
90
level.
Was the cap.
You would get to 90, you'd go 85 to 90, and no freaking joke, you'd do it in like 2 days. I did that on my death knight in like 2 days. You did it in one area, like the starter area. And like there were like 3 or 4 areas, and there were these huge open areas with no enemies or quests or any, and it was just like, what? Like, did they forget to design the game? Like, did they forget to create the fun? And then you'd like, you would literally, at level 90, it was like, okay, here's a like 10,000 dailies. And they were just like, it was like 5 different reputation factions that you would just do dailies for. And it was like, oh, this
That
just,
sounds really boring.
It was so bad, man. And that was, I started playing Mists of Pandaria for a few weeks on the lead up to Warlords of Draenor.
Yeah.
Excuse me, I had to drink
some of
my delicious tea. And that was my big thing, is like I played during that lead up to Warlords of Draenor, and then I played during Warlords of Draenor, but I played through Mists of Pandaria in literally like 4 or 5 in-game hours, like of playtime. And I did a lot of that was just like screwing around, like trying to relearn my class because I hadn't played in so long.
Yeah,
and then
especially
Warlords
if you play Paladin, they respec those or they redo those every 6 months.
And then Warlords of Draenor came out, and it was really cool at the start. And then, you know, you do a couple of areas, and you get to level 100, to be expected, you know, if you quest it hard. But then you get your garrison, and your garrison is this
Farmville?
Yeah, pretty much. It was this
That's
siphoned off area,
yeah.
Disconnected from any other players. Like, you would not see any other players, because it was quote-unquote your garrison. And while it's a cool concept that you could customize it a little, you still couldn't customize it that much. And then you were just totally disconnected from all other players in the game. And it's like, what is the point? Like, where is the, like, what is the, why? Like, why is this a thing right now? This should not be a thing. And they've brought some of that back for Legion. But they did it in a way that you still, you can see other players in the, it's like a hall, like a hall that you do quests for. And you still get followers, and there's still, like, the stuff that runs when you're offline type stuff. Which isn't a bad thing, but they made a companion app for it so that you can do it on your phone if you're at work or whatever, and then you don't have to, like, freak out and log in all the time.
Yeah.
Like, you don't have to log in right when you get home and then do it again before you leave for work to make sure that everything's done, and it's not a chore. And that's... They finally realized that people don't want it to be a chore.
Yeah, yeah.
So,
well,
it has a lot of... It has a lot of good stuff in it so far, and I'll admit, I'm not very far. I'm at level 102 on my... Because I bought the expansion and got a free level 100, and so I threw it out on the same server as Ray and Chris. And I've been enjoying it. I made a mage for the first time. I'd never played a mage before. Because my end goal is, if I really like the game, I'm going to transfer most, if not all, of my characters from my old server over to the new one. And I know that gets expensive, but I've got history with those characters.
I'm sure that's where they make most, not most, but some of their money.
They probably make a nice chunk of it, because that doesn't cost them anything. That's a load of garbage.
Oh, yeah, that's just a click.
yeah, it's just a data transfer. I mean, like, that's all automated. So, you know, they probably have a service that just does a copy from, you know, or just switches a flag for what server it's on.
yeah, it's just one big database.
Wouldn't surprise me. But no, I think every server has its own database of, you know, players, and items that each character has, and the amount of gold they have and stuff. But all it ends up doing is just copying that data over to the database for the server you're transferring to.
Oh, yeah, it's just a SQL query.
yeah, that's just it. It's probably a really well-built SQL query. And it just probably, you know, you pay them the money. It's $25, and it's way more money than I'd want to spend per character, but you pay the money, and boom, you're at another server. And I think the reason that they made this is because they knew people would quit the game and want to go play with their friends again. Mm-hmm. And I honestly, they're geniuses, because it's brilliant.
Oh, yeah.
Blizzard charges a lot for their services. They really do.
And they can, because, again, there's that sunk cost fallacy. Everybody's committed to what they did, especially if they raided, because that brings in the whole randomness of loot drops.
Correct.
And it's like, I don't want to do all that again.
Yep. But to be fair, they've added a lot of really cool stuff that really helps with that. Like your raid drops, like the really high-end tier gear and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. You actually unlock, and I put that in quotes, the the visual aspect of that item, so that you can actually transmogrify your current items, like your higher level stuff, to look like that. So if you've ever gotten the lower level tier gear, like the like tier 1 or tier 2 or tier 3, it'll unlock when you log into that character, and you can actually put that on that character or any other character on your account.
That's
and it's
nice.
Not just on your server. So this new character I made had all my pets from my old server, had all my mounts, had all my appearances, all that stuff. It was really cool.
Yeah.
So
one thing that I really like about Blizzard is that they take their good ideas from other games, because that's totally ripped off from Diablo.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just
Diablo had a lot of like the auction house stuff was from World of Warcraft.
Oh
that,
yeah,
that flopped, I know, but like it was still a cool idea.
It was a very bold idea, and that's definitely something I'll give them. I fear. And not fear, but I feel that the reason why they did the auction house, and I don't know if there's any documented reason why they did the auction house, but I feel the reason why they did the auction house is because they had to have some kind of income stream from having it online only. That's my guess anyway.
Yeah,
that they
some kind of reason.
Yeah.
They settled on the seasons, which was a better idea overall. And a less expensive idea overall, I think. Because when they got rid of the real money auction house, they fixed a lot of the complaints people had in general about the game. Mm-hmm. And I think that shows to me that Blizzard cares. Activision doesn't give two craps about it. So let me make that perfectly clear, because Activision is a soulless husk of an evil company, is what it is. And I hate Activision, and I hate that they own Blizzard. However, Blizzard does its best to make awesome stuff for reasonable prices. And I'm not going to say good prices, because their prices aren't good, but for reasonable prices. And I feel like Activision is like, nope, jack up that price. Make that more expensive. You gotta bring in more money than that. And I feel like it's just like evil. The Activision is the evil one on their shoulder, and Blizzard is, you know, Blizzard and its fan base are on the, you know, the angel on the other shoulder, and they're just arguing and doing a tug of war all the time, you know, that sort of thing. And as much as, you know, I despise Activision, Blizzard is still a really solid game. They make really cool stories. They do really good writing. Everything's very fun and really engaging with them. And that's just it. It's fun.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh my gosh. All right, so that is one of the big things that I have with Overwatch, now that we're talking about Blizzard.
Oh yeah, yeah.
The game is fun.
Oh yeah.
However, there are some glaring issues with that game that they will not fix. And this was one of the arguments that we had on stream that was very bothersome to me, was because there was a lot of shutting down of discussion around it. Like, I was trying to, like, discuss the my own opinions on it, and I, yeah, there was a lot of, well, they're never going to change, so, you know, they're never going to change, so you should just not even worry about it. And it's like, that's shutting down a discussion, not contributing not to a discussion. Something. Right. Which, I want to go in depth on in one of my, YouTube videos. Show series and a video someday, but it's a hard topic to broach without being boring, and I haven't quite figured out how I'm going to make that not boring. So, like how to discuss stuff without being a butthead, because I've been there where I've been a butthead, and I know full on, and it's not fun to discuss stuff with buttheads. So, I just don't know how to really package that without coming across as being, I don't know, holier than thou or something like that. That's not my goal. But anyway, so, one of the big arguments or discussion points that we had was that the game itself at its core is fun. However, it's the community that makes it not fun. The problem, and I feel like I'm talking a lot. I'm sorry if I am.
No, I've been talking a lot too.
I'm so hyped up on tea right now that it's like, oh, nuts. So hey, there's a spider in our wheat field. So the community around Overwatch is, at least on PC, I'm not speaking for the Overwatch community on consoles, because I can't. I don't know their community at all. They are a toxic bunch of individuals. And I'm not talking like League of Legends toxic, like that awful, like, you know, League of Legends has a reputation for awful community, and and you know, that's not what I'm talking about. Like, they're not that bad. However, they are a bunch of toxic individuals, and the reason that I say that, and I don't say that to generalize the overall community too much, but I find it to be mostly true. There's a lot of... if Blizzard has to make a change to the game, where when you put GG easy into chat, it changes you to I need my mommy or something like that, they know there's a toxicity issue. They know, because...
So funny.
It is. No. Their response was very funny, and I thought it was freaking hilarious. I agree 100%. But I feel like...
The fact
I feel
that
like,
the necessity to do it is there.
That's exactly.
It. No, I get
that's
it.
That's my thing. And so... You know, a lot of people don't really don't seem to really connect that. Hey, I got an achievement. Don't really seem to.
Repopulation.
Yeah, I don't know what that means. Let me see what that means. Breed two cows with wheat. Okay.
Oh, really?
I've done that 100,000 times.
Yeah, okay. I seem to get the same achievements every time we play. I don't know
why.
Which
is weird, because the server doesn't restart. It stays up the whole time that we're not on it. The toxicity in the community is what makes it not fun. And Blizzard doesn't... I don't know if they know what to do about it, which is weird, because they've made competitive games before, like StarCraft and stuff like that, and they don't have this kind of problem. Like, in Hearthstone, they made it so you can't even speak with the people. Like, you have to communicate to them through, like, pre-generated text bubbles and stuff like that, and, like, in-game speech. Like, you can't even talk yourself.
Yeah, and that's exactly what they should be doing in Overwatch.
Yeah, because here's the thing, is for me, and this is, let me preface this with, this is my experience. My experience is that people are trash-talky, people make accusations, which is, not necessarily a good thing, because, I mean... I've already watched a bunch of videos with hackers playing, where they recorded themselves playing, and you can tell they're hacking. It's very obvious when they have snapping and all that stuff, which, you know, it happens. It does happen, and I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but, like, I play with a guy who's amazing at sniping, and he gets accused of hacking almost every match we play. He doesn't hack, and I can tell you that he doesn't hack, because I've watched him play, and he's just good. Like, he never snaps, he never, like, and he's good in every game. He doesn't have a hack for every game he plays. He's just really good in every game he plays. So, he plays with a really low sensitivity, with a really big mouse pad on him, with his mouse, and he's just good at sniping. He does that whole, like really low DPI kind of sniping.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Which is, you know, it's a thing. It really is a thing. So, yeah, it's just there's so much salt in that community, and it's rubbed off on me a bit, and I hate that because I was doing so well playing games like co-op games like Insurgency and stuff like that, but playing like Battlefield 4 and stuff like that, I was doing so well on not being salty as hell every time I played a shooter. And going back into Overwatch, like, and the people just are such a-holes. They're just like, oh, you suck. You're crap. You're terrible. You should, you know, like, don't play the game. Sell your game. Quit. And just, like, or kill yourself even, like, as far as that, yeah, which is...
shit.
Yeah. And, like, oh my gosh, man, it's just so disgusting that anybody, you know, would think that's okay. And Blizzard had the functionality at one point where you could avoid players. There was an avoid this player function. And mm-hmm. I was like, that's a great idea because then I won't have to run into them anymore. And then it turns out I was getting put in games with them almost every time as if I had preferred them.
Oh.
And like, yeah, I was like seeing them over and I'm like, I avoided this person. And I would go and sure enough, the checkbox was checked that said avoid this player. And I'm like, what the F, dude? And then they ended up removing the feature without any fanfare. They just removed the feature. And I'm like, oh, that sucks. And there's so much they could have done with that. Like, if somebody got avoided too much, they'd get put in matches only with other avoided players. Like, there are just a billion things that they can do to really, like, rein in the negativity and the hate. Like, it was just hatred. Like, it's like, why? Why would you even... Like, I don't understand why you are so mad. Like it just, I don't know.
It's
just,
the internet. I mean, that's
I know.
That's a blanket excuse, but unfortunately, it's also kind of the real reason.
and you make a good point. It's just we as humans can do better. And like I know people like to troll, but usually it's not trolls that are being dickheads. It's people who just get mad because of one thing, and then they say stupid, rude, mean things.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know what my point is or what I'm trying to get across. I'm just, it's more of a just overall frustration with Blizzard and the way that, you know, the game is set up because the matchmaking is terrible. Toxicity is huge. Those two alone are enough to make me just not want to play the game because the matchmaking sucks in Overwatch. If you've ever like played it for a long period of time, you'll get put in matches with someone that's like a level 586, or you'll get up against a team that's a competitive team playing in casual and just stuff. And it's like, come on, like why is that not a segregated bunch? Like people that are just super good at the game should not be involved with people who want to play casually. It ruins the fun. And that's
for everybody.
That
well,
makes
probably not that,
no, not for them because they're having fun. And that was an argument that got leveraged against me, man. People were like, well, the other team's having fun, but Blizzard shouldn't be catering to half of their player base. Everyone should have a good time. That means a close match. If you lose, sure, you lost, but you gave it your best and it came close.
Yeah.
But if you get stomped and the game's over in 2 minutes, that sucks. That's a horrible, horrible design. And that is that was my whole point, is that you're not doing good game design if people aren't having fun. Games are games. They're meant to be fun. End of story.
Or, if not fun, have some kind of emotional equivalent.
Or have a story to tell. And Overwatch does not have a story to tell.
Well, it has a story. It's just paper thin.
Well, and it's buried under comic books and external stuff like Destiny was. And, like, if Destiny was just a straight multiplayer game, sure, that'd be fine. But I could go on. I'm not going to get on Destiny. We're at almost an hour. I don't want to keep, like... I'll be on Destiny for 10 years, so... So I apologize for ranting, so I got off there. But
it was a very good conversation, and I'm glad we had it.
Yeah,
and,
yeah. I have a lot of issues with the way that Overwatch is run, and it's not that the game's not fun, and it's not that the game's not balanced. In fact, I think the balance is the best it's ever been right now. It's just that the people are whiny and salty and just not fun to play with. That's my issue.
So we'll have a lot of cows to harvest when we come back next week.
Yep, and we'll have a bunch of chickens too.
A bunch of chickens.
Well, we're gonna have even more. Yeah.
Yeah, I think I got all of them.
Here's 1,000 eggs. Oh my god.
Yeah, I don't even know what we were gonna do with all those eggs.
I broke a bunch of them. I did like 4 or 5 stacks. Because I'm just breaking them, and if stuff comes out, stuff comes out.
Yeah.
One of those things. One of those deals.
Yeah. So I mean, I completely agree with all that. It's so easy to get wrapped up in all this stuff, and like it's a game, and that's the intent of the game, is just to have fun, or like I said, some kind of emotional equivalent of fun. Like sometimes you need to play a game to get sad or creeped out or.
But even then, they still have their own level of fun.
Entertainment.
Entertainment. It needs to be entertaining, and it's not entertaining if you're pissed.
Well, to most people.
Well, yeah, but I mean,
some people garner entertainment from being mad, but those people have other problems.
Yes, we'll say that much. But most of those people get entertainment from making other people mad.
Yeah.
AKA effing trolls. Anyways, so. Yeah, that's I've had my fill of that rant. I think we're done with this episode because we're an hour
or
so.
Hour and 41 seconds.
Well, do you want to wrap us up then?
Yeah, let's see if I can do that while I enchant this shovel. So, Tim, well, my part's easy. Tim, how about you tell us about yourself and where we can find you?
All right, here we go.
Thought you could trick me, huh?
You can find me on twitch.tv/insertcointheater. That's my primary stream. We are always hanging out and talking games or just shooting the breeze and having a good time. You can find me on YouTube, on youtube.com/insertcointheater.com. That's insertcointheater, D-O-T-C-O-M. You can also find me on Facebook at facebook.com/insertcointheater. On Twitter at twitter.com/insertcointim. You can also find me on the web at insertcointheater.com. Where can they find you, Mr. Ben Burns?
You can find me online at Ben_Burns. That's B-U-R-N-E-S. And that is at Twitter, Twitch, Patreon, and YouTube. I do produce a lot of music stuff, but like I say every time, I am working on creating more game stuff and other shows related to music and creativity. So there's a lot of stuff out there. And now that I'm talking, I have to burp, so I have to finish really fast. Okay. I think we're all good now. I think that's pretty much all we have for this episode. And thanks for watching, everybody. If you like this video, please consider giving us a thumbs up and subscribing to our respective channels.
Oh, yeah.
And that means a ton. Like for those who aren't familiar with how YouTube works, like that stuff gives you a ton more visibility. So
yes, it does.
Every little bit counts. So we'll see you guys in the next episode. And I didn't go to the title card now. Oh no. Anyway, I'll see you guys in the next episode. And have a good one.
Yep. Bye.
Bye.